Hello, my name is Zero and welcome to another Baldur's Gate 3 build video. In today's video we're finishing our series of the Dark Justiciar builds, with today's build being the Dark Justiciar Crusader. So this build will be primarily a fighter who will be multiclassing into a Shadow Monk for some of the benefits that Shadow Monk can give us, such as being able to cast Darkness for key points and also being able to get the Shadow Leap. Alright, so let's get into the character creation. So for your race, I would highly suggest that you pick a Drow Elf, like with the other builds, namely because you gain some nice cantrips and spells as you level up. For example, at level 5, you will get one free darkness spell per long rest. And then some of the features here that are nice is Fey Ancestry, which makes it so you have advantage against being charmed, and you can't be put to sleep by magic, and you have superior dark vision. Draw weapon training doesn't matter to us because we have all the weapon proficiencies since we are a fighter. For this subrace here, it is completely up to you. It is a flavor sort of thing. It doesn't really change your stats significantly or anything else really, mainly just dialogue and maybe some interactions. For a class, as mentioned before, we're going as a fighter. This fits us perfectly well, as we will be primarily a melee class that has some maneuverability. For the fighting style, we're going with the great weapon fighting. And then because if you observe the Crusaders in the Act 3, when you fight them, they are wielding greatswords, which is going to be what we will be wielding as well. So for the background, I'm going with the Guild Artisan, as mentioned before, my probably favorite background. Good skill bonuses and pretty decent amount of inspiration triggers. As always, if you have a preference, for your role-playing purposes, pick a background that fits you. You won't make a mistake by picking a different one, obviously. For the ability scores, we're going with 17 Strength, 14 Dexterity, 16 Constitution, and 10 Wisdom. 17 Strength, even though we are a monk, and monks can get dexterous attacks, we still have to rely on strength for our weapon attacks because we're wielding a great slash heavy weapons, such as the great swords. And the dexterous attack do not work on such weapons, so we still need high strength for our melee attacks to be reliable. We're picking 14 dexterity just so we can get that plus 2 armor class for armor and higher initiative, although later we will get an alert feat that will give us even more initiative. 16 constitution, so we have a lot more HP, and because of our armor we will be able to have concentration advantage on concentration saving throws, so it will be hard for us to break concentration on, let's say, Shield of Faith or Darkness. And then 10 Wisdom, just so we do not have a negative on Wisdom saving throw checks. Alright, so let's get into the rest of the levels. So at level 2, we unlock Action Search as a Fighter, but before we continue, I should mention, this build will be 6 levels Fighter, 6 levels Shadow Monk, so you have a choice. You can either start off as a Fighter and go for 6 levels, or start off as a Monk and go for 6 levels. I, in my playthrough, went as a fighter from the start, so I'll be going as a fighter in this example, because I think starting as a fighter is much more favorable, because you will unlock all of your weapon proficiencies or all of your armor proficiencies, and you will gain, for example, a very nice ability that is the Action Surge, nice and early. So that will be level 2. At level 3, we unlock our racial spell, Fairy Fire. All targets within the light turn invisible, attacks against them have advantage. This, you have to watch out though, this does target allies as well, unless you are an evocation wizard, but otherwise it can be a handy spell to gain advantage against enemies. For the subclass, we're going as a fighter champion, because we get the improved critical hit. The number you need to roll a critical hit while attacking reduced by 1. This effect can stack. We will try to reduce these numbers so it is easier for us to crit, but we will not try to get it as low as possible because it will not be really necessary. At level 4, we unlock our first feat, and here we will be picking ability improvement plus 2 into strength. At this point, or at level 5, you can choose to deal with on the Ethel, where you can gain a plus 1 to ability scores, where I would suggest you to get another point in strength. So you get strength to 20, so you get a nice plus 5 to the strength ability rolls. At level 5, we unlock our extra attack, and we unlock our racial spell, Darkness. A nice free handy Darkness spell cast once per long rest. At level 6, we unlock our second feat, and here we will be picking Alert. Mainly because, like the rest of the builds, we want alerts, so we try to play first or as close to being first, and so we also cannot be surprised, which is quite handy. At level 7, this is when we are going to be multiclassing into the monk. Well, as mentioned before, we do not gain the benefit of the dexterous attacks, as dexterous attacks do not work with weapons that are heavy or two-handed. So great swords, great axes, and I believe halberds do not work with dexterous attacks, so they will not be triggering our bonus unarmed strike, which is fine, because we will not need to rely on them all that much anyway. Then at level 8 we unlock additional key points and we unlock patient defense, step of the wind dash, and disengage. These are bonus actions that cost key points. At level 9 we unlock the deflect missiles, which is rather handy, and then we unlock also our subclass, which we'll be choosing Way of the Shadow. Reason for it, we gain Shadow Arts Hide as a bonus action, which is nice. But namely, we want this because we also unlock the Shadow Arts Darkness. We can cast Darkness for 2 key points every time. And then Shadow Arts Pass Without Trace can be handy, but not all that much. Dark Vision we don't need because we have Superior Dark Vision. And then Silence can be handy because you can silence creatures from casting spells or from calling for help. And you also get a Minor Illusion, which you can also utilize if you need to, for grouping up enemies or displacing them. At level 10, we unlock our third and last feat, and this feat will be Great Weapon Master. So at this point, you should or can already have immunity to blindness, and you will be utilizing Great Weapon Master pretty much non-stop, because as always, you should and will pretty much always fight enemies from darkness. While they are blinded, you are not, and you will have advantage pretty much always, and this will be always handy to you, unless an enemy has a ridiculously high armor class or they are not blinded by your spell. So then you can just, of course, turn it off, but pretty much for most of the playthrough from here on you will be using this as it being turned on. At level 11 we unlock the Stunning Strikes, so melee and unarmed, which are quite handy. You also unlock the Cloak of Shadows, which is you wrap yourself in shadows and become invisible, and you break this invisibility if you attack early, cast another spell, take an action, or take damage. This can come in handy, but it will not be very useful all that much to us. And lastly, at level 12, we unlock the Shadow Step, which is going to be very nice for us, as we will use it every single time if we are able to use it to teleport to another area, or if we are not going to use our bonus action Great Weapon Extra Attack. Alright, so now we are going to be going to the equipment section, so I will see you there. Alright, so here we are in the equipment section, so let's get into it. For our helmet, we are going with the Dark Justiciar helmet. This gives us the magical durability effect. The wielder has +1 bonus to saving throws against spells, and we also gain Covert Critical. While obscured, the number you need to roll a critical hit while attacking is reduced by 1. This effect can stack, and it will stack with our champion subclass and our ranged weapon for a total of 17, potentially 16 if we use Elixir of Viciousness. For the alternatives, you can wear the Covert Cowl, which has the same Covert Critical effect, but has Dexterity saving throws +1 instead of Constitution saving throws +1. Also, instead you could wear the Cyrox Horned Helmet, which gives you Deathbringer's Sight. You gain Dark Vision up to the range of 3 meters or 15 if you already have it. This first half of the effect is wasted on us, as we have Superior Dark Vision and we can see in the dark up to 24 meters. The second half is very useful though, because this reduces the roll required for a critical hit by 1 without a prerequisite. So we don't need to be obscured like with the Covert Critical. This just flat out is applied non-stop. The second effect you gain is the Dauntless. You can't be frightened, you cannot be affected with other emotion altering conditions, which can be quite handy. For the cloak, we're going with the Cloak of Protection, armor class +1 and save throws +1. Nothing really special, just a nice little cloak you can get at the beginning of Act 2. Alternatively, you can use the Flesh Melter cloak. When the wearer deals damage with a creature deals damage to the wearer with a melee attack, that creature takes 1d4 acid damage. Both of the gloves are nice to have, but for this character in particular, cloaks aren't all that important, and you wouldn't do a major mistake of not equipping cloak at all if you don't have any. For the armor, we're going with the Dark Justiciar half plate. While obscured, the wearer has an advantage on stealth checks. You could combine this effect of Shara's Umbra with the Pass Without Trace to potentially gain quite strong capability or ability to hide and remain hidden in obscured areas. But mainly what we want, why we want this armor is A, aesthetics, and B, advantage on constitution saving throw checks. And as you may know, constitution saving throws are concentration saving throws, so this gives us advantage on concentration saving throws, meaning because most of our spells that we are using are concentration, we will have advantage in saving against those, making it quite harder for us to break concentration. And you gain Shara's Aegis, which is just Shield of Faith, which gives you +2 armor class once per long rest. For the alternative, you can wear the Dark Justiciar half plate, the very rare version. This has the same effect of Shara's Umbra, but also has Shara's protection. While the wearer has Shield of Faith active, reduce all incoming damage by 2 and reflect the damage received back at the attacker, who takes 1d4 necrotic damage. And also has the advantage on constitution saving throw checks and Shara's Aegis once per long rest. For our gauntlets, we're going with the Dark Justiciar gauntlets. Your weapon attacks deal additional 1d4 necrotic damage and strength saving throws +1. Alternatively, you can wear the Dark Justiciar gauntlets rare version. It has the same effects, but this one gives you a Beckoning Darkness spell. Now, the Beckoning Darkness spell will not be useful for us once we unlock Shadow Step and Great Weapon Master bonus action attack, because we will have quite a few contenders for our bonus actions. These gauntlets are much better on somebody like a Dark Justiciar cleric, who will have much more uses out of these gloves. But if you don't have anybody wearing them, you can totally just wear the rare version of the Dark Justiciar gauntlets. For the boots, we're going with the Evasive Shoes. Acrobatics +1, armor class +1. A nice little piece of boots or piece of equipment that gives you additional armor class, so we now have a total of 20. For the alternatives, you of course can wear the Deceased Nightwalkers, can't be enwrapped, entangled, ensnared, or can't slip on grease or ice. You can use the Dark Justiciar boots, though these primarily you would wear for just aesthetics. You wouldn't probably wear them for the effects. Dexterity saving throws are okay. Shadow Teleport is horrible. It is a action once per short rest teleportation that doesn't give you advantage in your next attack, because if you compare it to the Shadow Step, you gain teleport from shadow to shadow. Afterwards, you have advantage on your next attack roll once per turn, right? You can use it every single turn, and it's a bonus action. Well, this one you can use 3 times per long rest, right? It's a lot worse. So again, it's if you just want aesthetics, that's about it. Other boots we have here are the Silver Sea Shoes. Jump distance increased by 1.5 meters, acrobatics +1. Nice piece of boots if you want to gain even more jumping distance on top of your very high distance already, because you could have 24 strength. And then last but not least, Boots of Striding. When you cast a spell that requires concentration, you gain momentum, and while concentrating, you can't be knocked prone or moved against your will. These boots are absolutely amazing on characters who are, for example, clerics, who will be concentrating a lot, because the only way you can break, or enemies can break your concentration, is they deal a lot of damage to you to consistently roll your concentration saving throws, out of which we have advantage. And again, you can't be knocked prone, so they cannot break your concentration by knocking you prone. So amazing boots for example, clerics. But also this character, because we have just pretty much all of the concentration spells ever. For our amulet, we're going with the Surgeon's Subjugation amulet. We gain Paralyzing Critical. Once per long rest, while scoring a critical hit on a humanoid, the wearer can paralyze the target for 2 turns. A very handy amulet that we will be able to trigger quite reliably, as we will have a 17, potentially 16 on a roll to crit. So I would use this, but alternatively, if you have this on somebody else, you can wear the Amulet of Global Health. This is your Constitution 23, advantage on Constitution saving throw checks, which we already have, but 23 Constitution is nice, because then you can remove all of your points from Constitution and put them into Dexterity and Wisdom, or maybe if this is your main character, you can put some in Charisma. to gain some additional dialogue bonuses. Alternatively to that, you can wear the amulet of Misty Step. You gain Misty Step once per short rest. Very simple and quite useful. It can be useful for that Misty Step ability. For our melee weapon, we're going with the Sword of Chaos. You gain 1d4 necrotic damage additionally to our gloves, so we now deal 2d4 necrotic damage, and you gain Chaos. On a hit, you gain 1d6 hit points. For our purposes and for aesthetics, a quite nice greatsword. Of course, there are better ones if you really want to use better ones, but for the sakes of theming and so on, this is going to do us quite well. For the alternatives, you can use the Everburn Blade, you can use the Sword of Beast Woundseeker. This weapon has been the one I've been rolling with until I got the Sword of Chaos, because this gives you Deepen the Wound. The wielder gains 1d4 bonus to attack rolls with this weapon when attacking creatures who have already taken damage. A quite decent little effect there. You can also use the Sword of Justice. This gives you Tears Protection, so an additional cast of Shield of Faith once per short rest. Or you can also use the Jorgul's Greatsword, which gives you the Colossal Onslaught effect, channel your metal some strength, and strike all creatures in a line in front of you. For our ranged weapons, we're going with the Deadshot. It gives us improved critical. The number you need to roll a critical hit while attacking is reduced by 1, so stacking with our helmet and the champion, this is 17, like mentioned before. It also gives us the Keen Attack. The wielders double their proficiency bonus when rolling ranged attack with this weapon, unless they have disadvantage. So, meaning we will have a decent, or quite decent chance of hitting enemies with our ranged weapons, even though we have relatively low dexterity. For the alternatives, you can use the Hunting Shortbow. You have advantage against monstrous type enemies, and you gain Hunter's Mark. Or you can use the Gandril's Aspiration. You gain, again, advantage against monstrosity type enemies, but you instead get Sacred Munitions. Infuse your crossbow bolts with holy energy. Your ranged weapon attacks possibly inflict turn undead. And also, you could use the Hellrider Longbow. You gain +3 bonus to initiative rolls and advantage on ability checks. And then the Fiendish Fire effect will not work because we will not be using this bow to attack all that much. But what it does is, it's once per turn, a creature hit by this weapon will possibly be affected with Fairy Fire. Alright, now before we get into the combat showcase, I just want to mention that if you want to roll with a full party of characters that are immune to blindness, you can, though, again, if you want this to be like Dark Justiciar, for example, you can do it, though just two of them will have very wild pieces of helmet. One of them will have to wear the Helldusk helmet, which does give you immunity to blindness, and the Steel Watcher helmet, it also gives you immunity to blindness. So you can roll with a full party of Dark Justiciars. They'll just have, two of them will have weird helmets, and then I believe one of them will have a different armor because there are only two Dark Justiciar armors in the game and only two gauntlets. But yes, it is possible to roll a full-on Dark Justiciar party. You can also try to finesse into it two levels of Warlock, so you get Devil's Sight, which makes it so you can still see through magical darkness, but you can be blinded with Devil's Sight. Alright, now, but let's go into that battle showcase. Alright, so here we are, the Flaming Fist Barracks for yet another battle showcase. So combat with this character will be rather simple and straightforward. If there are enemies inside of darkness, you would go and smack them around, or if conveniently enough there is a annoying wizard right next to you knocked prone, you could go and hit them instead. Now, to show you the accuracy you can expect while enemies are blinded with darkness, we have a quite high chance of hitting here, but this is, in my case, higher than usual because I have favorable beginnings. The first attack roll ability check you make against any target gains a bonus equal to your proficiency. So we would I'm gonna try to hit him. So we got a crit and we can paralyze him, but we will not do it. Let's see the actual accuracy. So 88, that's still quite good. I would take this. I would not be turning great weapon master off for this. So let's try to hit him. All right so we got another crit there. So now let's say if for some reason your crusader got first in the roll, he's first and the rest of the party isn't, you could have him plop down darkness spell if you want to, for example, obscure your entire party. Or if you want him to be aggressive, you could have him go and try to, for example, shoot an arrow of darkness at an enemy and then rush towards them to fight them. But since we don't need to, in this case we already have darkness set up. You can also, if there is a potentially, let's say, a dangerous target, you could try to use the handy stunning strike on them, or of course paralyze them, even though we didn't need to do this here because he was stunned, but regardless. So yeah, that's the build, that's the video. I hope you enjoyed. I would appreciate it if you liked and subscribed, and I will see you in the next one.